السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. وعنده مفاتح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هو ويعلم ما في البر والبحر وما تسقط من ورقة إلا يعلمها ولا حبة في ظلمات الأرض ولا رطب ولا يابس إلا في كتاب مبين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحاب سيدنا ومولانا محمد معدن الجود والكرم منبع العلم والحلم والحكم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبارك وسلم. ثم أما بعد. الحمد لله, we gather for the recitation and the commentary of the hadith of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم through Imam Nawawi's Riyadh al-Saliheen, and we continue through the chapter of باب في الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر, the chapter of commanding the good and prohibiting the evil. And we've reached hadith number 188, which is where we will continue from in today's lesson, in today's session, inshallah. And the chapter is an incredibly important chapter. In the previous hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a very beautiful and evident example of how those who are qa'im upon the haqq and how those who are qa'im upon the guidance of Islam and busy themselves in helping others on this path are like those in a ship, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are two levels to this ship, the bottom and the top. And the ones at the bottom want to make a hole in the bottom of the ship in order to get water. Little do they realize that making that hole will cause the whole ship to sink and everybody to be destroyed. And the ones above stop them from doing that. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is the same as the people who followed their desires as compared to those who command the good and prohibit the evil. They are holding everyone behind from destruction. And this is the in the same meaning, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us another hadith in which he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that the example of me and you is like a man sat at a fire and there are flies coming towards this fire whilst he is dispelling the flies away from the flames. So he said, I am holding you by your belt, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or by your collars, whilst you are launching yourself into the fire of Jahannam. So this is the reality of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his sunnah, and the reality of commanding the good and prohibiting the evil. Through it we are saved from the fire of Jahannam. So it is an incredibly important duty in our deen, one that we must continue to maintain until the day of judgment. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam has told us that Allah ta'ala, when he sends the punishment, he does not send it to those who only perform the evil, but he sends it to those who do not do the evil but stand by and watch as it takes place and do not prohibit it as well. We continue then from hadith number 188, inshallah, narrated by Sayyida Salama radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Junaid, you want to read the hadith? Bismillah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. An Umm al-Mu'minin, Hind bint Abi Umayya Hudayfa, radiyallahu anha, anna an-Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, annahu qal, innahu yusta'malu alaykum umara'u fata'rifuna wa tunkiruna. فمن كره فقد بريا ومن أنكر فقد سلم ولكن من رضي وتابع قالوا يا رسول الله ألا نقاتلهم قال لا ما أقام فيكم الصلاة معناه من كره بقلبه
ولا we can leave, you can leave the tafsir of the hadith, we can go to the translation inshallah.
Umm al-Mu'mineen, Umm Salma, Hind bint Abi Umayya, Hudhayfa, reported the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Amirs will be placed over you and you will acknowledge and object to...
Yani Amirs, leaders will be placed over you, yep. You will acknowledge and...
you will acknowledge and object to some of what they do. Anyone who shows dislike is innocent, and anyone who objects is safe. However, there will be those who are content and follow them. They said, Messenger of Allah, should we not fight them? He said, no. Not as long as they establish the prayer among you.
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallam. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that Allah Ta'ala will send or will place upon you kings, umara, yasta'milu alaykum umara, there will be leaders above you. And the status of these leaders, ta'rifun wa tunkirun, you will recognize, yani you will approve of, you will approve of some of their a'mal because it is muwafiq to the sharia. Wa tunkirun, you will not approve of some of their actions because of their opposition to the sharia of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these are the actions of the umara that will come after the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam. And this is after the Khilafat al-Rashida, you had the Khilafah, or you had the leadership being passed to those who were not suitable, the likes of Yazid and those that followed. This is who make the dua. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ra'si sittin wa imarati sibyan. O Allah, I ask your protection and ask your refuge from the year 60 and the leadership of children, he would say, radiyallahu ta'ala an. And Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu an was given special knowledge by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, if I revealed that knowledge, you would have to cut this throat of mine. Part of that was of the events which were to follow after the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam and the Khilafah al-Rashida. So he said, I seek refuge from the year 60 and the leadership of children. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, he said, radiallahu ta'ala an. So these are those umara that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam is discussing, that they will, their actions will be mukhalif to the sharia of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Messenger, how do we as followers then, we are not leaders, we are those that are under the leadership of certain people. So what? How do we deal with them, and how is our heart commanded to be with the leaders that do that which is mukhalif to the sharia? Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam told us, فَمَنْ كَرِهَا, whoever dislikes, يعني بِقَلْبِهِ الْمُنْكِرِ وَلَمْ يَقْدِرْ عَلَى الْإِنْكَارِ لِخَوْفِ سَطْوَتِهِمْ, a person who dislikes that which they do. Okay, they dislike that which is the leaders do, but they are unable to prohibit it because they are fearful of their harm that they may cause it. فَقَدْ بَرِئَ, they are free of responsibility, said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani, this is still iman. أَضْعَفُ iman is to hate it in the heart, but it is still iman, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we also learnt in the previous hadith that from the shara'it of the obligation of amal bil ma'roof wal nahi anil munkar is that you do not fear harm to yourself from those people that you are commanding or prohibiting. So whoever hates it, then whoever dislikes what they do, faqad bari'a, they are free from any sin, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because they are li'annahu qa'imun bima yajibu alayhi min taghyirihi biqalbi. They have fulfilled that which is necessary upon them, and that was to change it with their, or to hate it with their heart, as the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded. They've done their responsibility. Man ankara faqad salima, yani whoever does inkar, they deny, they refute that action, and they do it, and they are able to do it either with their hand or their tongue depending on their status in society. Faqad salima, they are secured from what? Min al-iqab al-ukhrawi, from the afterlife, because they spoke out against the evil. And then finally he said, وَلَكِنْ مَنْ رَضِيَ وَتَابَعَ, but there will be those who are pleased with the evil and they will follow, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is their status? يعني فَهُوَ الَّذِي لَمْ تَبْرَأْ ذِمَّتُهُ وَلَمْ يُسْلِمْ مِنْ إِثْمٍ فَعَلَيْهِمْ لِمُشَارَكَتِهِ لَهُمْ فِيهِ وَرِضَاهُ بِهِ. So these people, because they did not prohibit the evil, they are not secure from sin. They are not secure from sin, and the sin is upon them. Their sin is upon them because they are musharik. They are taking part in that by not speaking out against that particular evil. And so their responsibility is not lifted off their shoulders, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The Messenger of Allah was then asked by the Sahaba about these leaders. Ya Rasulullah, alla nuqatiluhum. Ya Allah, ya Rasul, alla nuqatiluhum. Ya Rasulullah, shall we not fight them if they are this misguided? And the Messenger of Allah, he said, no, as long as they establish the salah. As long as they establish the salah. Okay? And the reason for this, as we mentioned in the previous lessons, is what? حَذْرًا مِنْ تَهِيجِ الْفِتَنِ وَاخْتِلَافِ الْكَلِمَةِ وَغَيْرِ ذَلِكَ مِمَّا يَكُونُ أَشَدَّ نَكَارَةً مِنْ إِحْتِمَالِ نُكْرِهِمْ وَالْمَضَارَةِ عَلَى مَا يُنْكِرُ مِنْهُمْ. It is in order to preserve the greater good. It is in order to preserve the spreading of fitan, of civil strife and civil war. It is in order to prevent opposition and disunity amongst the people, and things which are far worse than this, which will come as a result of openly speaking out or openly fighting against or fighting against those that are in leadership, but they do that which is impermissible. So this is the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching us to look after the greater good. So this is the status of the ummah that he's telling us sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the latter days, and for us is to be patient upon such leaders he has told us sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We come to hadith number 189, inshallah.
An Umm al-Mu'mineen, Umm al-Hakam Zainab bint Jahsh, radiallahu anha, anna al-Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dakhala alayha fazi'an yaqulu, la ilaha illallah, waylun li'arabi min sharrin qad iqtarab, futih al-yawm min radmi ya'juj wa ma'juj mithlu hadhi, wa halqa bi'asbu'ayhi الإبهام والتي تليها فقلت يا رسول الله أنهلك وفينا الصالحون قال نعم إذا كثر الخبث متفق عليه
الله أكبر
أم المؤمنين أم الحاكم زينب بنت جحش reported that once the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم became upset and said there is no God but Allah, bow to the Arabs from evil which is drawing near. An opening has been made in the wall of Ya'juj and Ma'juj like this. And he made a circle with thumb and forefinger. I said, O Messenger of Allah, will we be destroyed when the righteous are among us? He said, yes, if there is a lot of wickedness agreed upon.
Allahu Akbar. So this is an incredibly powerful hadith of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. First we come to the tarjuma of the rawiya of the hadith, who is none other than Ummul Mu'mineen Sayyida Zainab bint Jahsh radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Sayyida Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha is the daughter of Amima bint al-Muttalib, who was the ammah. She was the paternal auntie of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So Sayyida Zainab is her daughter. She accepted Islam very early, migrated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Medina, and Rasulullah married her in the fifth year after Hijrah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she, radiallahu ta'ala anha, we know that she married Sayyidina Zayd ibn al-Haritha, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He divorced her. And after the iddah, Allah ta'ala declared that she would be in nikah. She would be in nikah to the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ahzab, فَلَمَّا قَضَى زَيْدٌ مِّنْهَا وَتَرًا زَوَّجْنَاكَهَا. Allah ta'ala says, when Zayd had completed from her the period of iddah, we married her to you, Allah Ta'ala says. Zawajnakaha, we married her to you. This is a great fakhr for Sayyida Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, that she was married to Rasulullah by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly in the Quran. Hence she used to very proudly express this to the Azwaj. She used to say radiallahu ta'ala anha, Zawajani Allahu min as-sama, Allah married me in the heavens, she would say, radiallahu ta'ala anha. This is Sayyida Zainab. And she was known for her generosity. Known for her generosity, for incredible amounts of sadaqah. Hatta she would put together baskets, sell them, and give the proceeds of that towards sadaqah. She was incredibly generous. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that before he passed away, he said, the first one of you, yani his azwaj, he said, the first one of you to join me will be atwaluhunna yadan, the ones with the longest hands. And this is an expression to mean sadaqa, the one who is the most generous in giving sadaqa. And that was Sayyida Zainab bint Jahsh. She was the first of the ummahatul mu'mineen to pass away following the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wasallam. She is buried in Jannatul Baqi, and her janazah was performed by Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. So she narrates then that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam دخل عليها فزعًا. He entered upon her very, very in a startled manner, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hakada, this is how the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in other ahadith, he would awake in the night incredibly worried, alayhi salatu wasalam. There are other ahadith where he wakes up in the middle of the night with similar words, worried about oncoming fitan. And in other hadith, he would say, who knows what Allah has sent down in terms of fitan? And who knows what difficulties are awaiting? He would say, كاسيات في الدنيا عاريات في الآخرة. Many of those who are clothed in the dunya will be without the libas in the akhirah, يعني they will be exposed. And so, he would quickly then, after feeling this kayfiyah, he would go and he would wake up all of the azwaj, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He'd wake them all up and he would wake them for the salah. When he would experience such a kayfiyah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the kamal of khashya of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His exceptional fear of Allah, especially since the unseen was opened to him by Allah. He was aware of the fitan which awaited the ummah and the difficulties which were awaiting the ummah, and so he had great concern for his ummah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is this great concern which led him to wake up in the nights fearful of that fitna coming towards his ummah alayhi salatu wasalam. Yani a man who did not even sleep comfortably out of the worry of his ummah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Harisun alaykum, Allah Ta'ala says he is deeply concerned for you. Bil mu'minina raufur rahim, he is kind and gentle towards the believer sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is his status alayhi salatu wasalam. So in the same way he woke up in this night as well, and he said alayhi salatu wasalam, la ilaha illallah, as he would say whenever something worried him alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he said, waylun lil arab min sharrin qad iqtarab, woe be to the Arabs because of the evil which is drawing closer to them. He said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and what is this shar which is drawing closer to the Arabs? This was the ishara by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to the fitan which would take place in the khilafah of Sayyidina Uthman and everything which would follow. It is a reference to that, as Ibn Hajar mentions in Fathul Bari. So he is talking about this fitan which will come to the Arabs after his passing alayhi salatu wasalam, and everything which follows. And this is without a doubt manifest before our very eyes, even in the modern world. Okay, that the places which were the center of Islam are no longer can be called the same, unfortunately, due to the prevalence of fitan in such lands. And so he said alayhi salatu wasalam, woe to the Arabs because of the fitan which is coming close to them, close to them alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he said, today a hole has been made in the wall of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, and he circled between his fingers sallallahu alayhi wasallam to demonstrate the hole alayhi salatu wasalam. And he did it tightly such that there was a very tight gap between his fingers to show the extent of the hole which had been opened up in the wall of the Ya'juj and Ma'juj. We know the Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us about them in the Quran. They are not creatures, neither are they aliens or any of the rest of the conspiracy theories which we hear about, but they are human beings. They are tribes of human beings, and we know that they were confronted by Sayyiduna Dhul-Qarnayn in the Quran, and he assisting his people who asked him for assistance, he blocked them behind a wall, as Allah Ta'ala mentions the Quran. And asked for nothing in return for that. So he blocked them behind that wall. قَالَ هَذَا رَحْمَةٌ مِّن رَبِّ فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ رَبِّ جَعَلَهُ دَكَّاءً. This is by the mercy of my Lord that they were blocked and their fitna was kept locked away from the people. When the command of my Lord will come, جَعَلَهُ دَكَّاءً, then they will be able to escape. So this is the hole that was produced in the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, hence his worry alayhi salatu wasalam. Now upon hearing this, Sayyida Ummul Mu'mineen Sayyida Zainab radiyallahu ta'ala anha became incredibly worried seeing the Messenger of Allah in such a state. She asked him, Ya Rasulullah, anahluk wafina salihun? Ya Rasulullah, anahlik wafina salihun? amongst us there are so many good people, will we still suffer the consequences, Ya Rasulullah? And he said, Na'am, idha kathur al-khabath. When the evil is prevalent, then yes, you will be affected as well, he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is the asl maqsad of this hadith. The Messenger, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is teaching us, Alayhi Salatu Wasalam, that أن الخبث إذا كثر فقد يحصل الهلاك العام وإن كثر الصالحون. When evil is rife in any society, then a commonplace difficulty reaches those people. A commonplace difficulty from Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala reaches those people, even if there is many righteous people. He mentions in the commentary, ففيه بيان شؤم المعصية والتحريض على إنكارها. So the hadith explains to us the negative effects of sin and the importance of prohibiting them. And what we don't understand is, and what is incredibly important for us to understand is, just as our a'mal have, they can have physical consequences, they also have athar, spiritual athar, in the realm of the unseen. That's why Allah Ta'ala tells us that you see ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. You see that the corruption manifests on the land and the earth because of the actions of the people, Allah Ta'ala says. So what is this? This is the imbalance in the land and the sea because of the ma'asi of the people. That's what it is. So sin has physical traces as well as spiritual traces, which cause an imbalance in our existence and our world. Hatta Imam Shawliullah Ad-Dihlawi Rahmatullahi Ali mentions in Hujjatullah Al-Baligha, he mentions in this book that our a'mal are connected to the malaika. When we do good actions, it sets off almost a chain reaction, he mentions, Rahmatullahi Ali. And this khair, or this goodness, it goes to the malaika. And the malaika, upon experiencing this khair and witnessing this khair and seeing this good, they, out of ecstasy and out of appreciation of this action of good, they, the malaika, also release anwar. The malaika, they give out lights. And then that, and they make dua of mercy for the one who is performing the good. And that mercy then trickles down and descends on the world. So these are good a'mal which reflect their actions and their traces reflect on the world. And likewise, the opposite is true. When negative a'mal are done, then this is also raised up to the malaika and they experience a deep dislike for that. And that releases also negative athar, and they curse and dislike the one who performs that action, which also manifests itself and makes its way down to the earth. And the effects of that are zahir in and around the world. So when evil is rife in the society, then if we do not prohibit that evil and free ourselves from our responsibility in Islam, that evil will affect all of us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for afiyah. And we ask Allah Ta'ala to protect us from bala and fitan. For our actions, ما أصابكم من مصيبة فبما كسبت أيديكم. Whatever difficulty comes your way, it is through the earnings of your own hands, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says. And if you preserve the commands of Allah, احفظ الله يحفظك. You preserve the boundaries of Allah, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will preserve and protect you from bala, from fitan, from his azab, from his iqab, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim wa salli ala. This is why Rasulullah would always make dua. He would always make dua for protection from the fitan. Ma zahara minha wa ma batan. The zahir and the apparent. He would make dua. He would teach us to recite certain litanies, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the morning and the evening. He told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, to recite Bismillahi alladhi la yadurru ma asmihi shay'un fil ardi wa la fis sama'i wa huwa as-sami'ul 'alim. This dua, three times in the morning, three times in the evening. Whoever does this will not be affected by tribulations throughout that day, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasalam. So these are litanies from the Rasul, which we should take into consideration. He's advised us, and we should take them into consideration and protect ourselves from tribulation. And of course, the greatest way of protecting ourselves from tribulation is to prohibit the evil and stop it from taking place in our communities and our societies. We come to the next hadith, inshallah, hadith number 190. Bismillah.
An Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, radiyallahu anhu, anna al-Nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, qal, Iyakum al-julusa fit-turuqati. Faqalu ya Rasulallah, ma lana min majalisina buddun, natahaddathu fiha. Faqala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فإذا أبيتم إلا المجلس فأعطوا الطريق حقا. قال وما حق الطريق يا رسول الله؟ قال غض البصر وكف الأذى ورد السلام والأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر.
سبحان الله.
متفق عليه. أبو سعيد الخدري reported that Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Be aware of sitting in the roadways." They said, "Messenger of Allah, we must have places where we can sit and talk together." The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you must sit there, then give the roadway its rights. They asked, what are the rights of the roadway? Messenger of Allah, he said, lowering the eye, refraining from causing annoyance, returning the greeting, commanding the right and forbidding the wrong.
Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim wa salli. This is an incredibly beautiful hadith and a very practical hadith for us to implement. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam has told us, what iyyakum wal julus fi turuqat, be aware of sitting in pathways, and not just pathways, any public area where people are coming and going, where people are coming and going and passing from one place to another. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has commanded us from sitting in such an area. This is part of the sunnah. And so we should not be amongst those who gather on street corners and spend our time there, or gather on the streets in groups and stand there or sit there. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not approve of this too much, alayhi salatu wasalam, because it's a public area. Everybody has a right to that area, and gathering in these types of areas often causes a disturbance to the passers, to those who are passing by. It disturbs them. It causes them sometimes worry, especially if they are older and, you know, it's a group of youngsters there, you know, with their hoods on usually, you know, doing whatever they're doing in the street corners. And sometimes for the elderly, it is worrying. Okay, it worries them. And the public paths, they are for everybody to use. And so the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is encouraging us to be considerate of everybody who is walking past. And hence he has told us, do not sit on the pathways or sit in public ways where everybody is passing you, he said, alayhi salatu wasalam. Any public area. Now, the Sahaba, they said to him, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, ya Rasulullah, ma lana min majalisina buddun, natahaddathu fiha. Ya Rasulullah, we need somewhere to talk. We need somewhere where we can gather and we can discuss things with one another. And this is the Sahaba, ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een. They, if they gathered, فَإِنَّ مَجَالِسَهُمْ كَانَتْ مَصُونَةً عَمَّا لَا يَعْنِيهِمْ مِنَ الْمُبَاحَثَاتِ. يعني the Sahaba, their gatherings were not filled with evil talk, and were not filled with vain talk and talk of misguidance. They were preserved of all of, they didn't talk about, you know, things which didn't concern them, the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. But they followed the guidance of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. But they wanted a place where they could talk about good things, any khuyur dunyawiya wal ukhrawiya, dunyawi, ukhrawi, good things, you know, discuss with one another, be friendly with one another, catch up with one another. They needed a place for that. So the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam told them then, فَإِذَا أَبَيْتُمْ إِلَّا الْمَجْلِسِ. He said alayhi salatu wasalam, yani if you've got no other, yani فَإِذَا أَبَيْتُمْ سَائِرُ لَفَعَلْ إِلَّا الْجُلُوسِ فِي الطُّرُقَاتِ. Yani if the only thing you can do is sit here, you haven't got anywhere else to go. There's no other place for you to sit. There is no other place for you to gather. Then he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, فَأَعْتُ الطَّرِيقَ حَقَّهُ. Give the road and the path its right, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Yani, it demands adab. If you are sitting in the streets or you're gathering in the road, then that demands from us adab, he is telling us, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Adab, he is telling us, alayhi salatu wa salam. He tells us, ghaddul basar. Number one, lowering the gaze, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. And this is incredibly important. First of all, this is a hukm by Allah to the believing men and the believing women. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Prophet say to the believing men, they should lower their gaze. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنْ. And O Prophet, tell the believing women that they should also lower their gaze. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, so lowering the gaze is a command of the Qur'an. The first gaze is permissible if it is ittifaqan, yani it just happens. Not the first gaze intently to check out what's going, to check out any person or to look at them intently. That is not permissible. The first gaze is permissible if it's done ittifaqan, yani it happens. The second one is not, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said that the gaze is what? Is an arrow from the arrows of the shaitan, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because it is through the gaze that the shaitan traps a person into fitan. Hence we've been commanded to lower our gaze, he has told us, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So, ghaddul basar, to lower our eyes. And this is incredibly important. Alright, we have incredibly sometimes bad manners, staring at people who are in cars, or cars, people who are in cars staring at people who are walking by on the sides. Hatta they will turn their heads to see and watch the people walking on the streets as if they've never seen another person before. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this was not from his adab, neither his akhlaq. The Sahaba describe in the Shama'il of Imam al-Tirmidhi, jullu nadhruhu al-mulahadha. Most of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's looks were just mulahadha, yani a glance. Then he would look down again, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Most of his looking, he would glance, then he would look down, alayhi salatu wasalam. And most of his time, he would spend looking down rather than looking up and around, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because he was constantly in fikr about how to guide the ummah. But that was his adab, alayhi salatu wasalam. He would not raise his eyes and stare at people. Jullu nadhruhu al-mulahadha. He would... His nadhar alayhi salatu wasalam, most of it was what? Just a glance, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasalam. So these are adab which we should take from him. And all of this comes from min husni islam al-mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'ni. From the beauty of a person's Islam, they leave that which doesn't concern them. Yani, what concern do people on the road who are walking past have to do with us? What clothes they are wearing, or where they are going, or what they are doing? None of this has any concern to us at all. Concern ourselves with our own selves. This is the command of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, not to stare at people. So if you have to be in the streets, then give the streets their right. Number one, lower the gaze, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Don't stare at anyone. And these are adab which the modern world is now calling for. Okay? Following the case of the innocent lady who was murdered by the police officer in London, there were calls, okay, by officials saying that women are not safe on the streets in cities like London, and for there to be stronger laws against things like catcalling and harassment to women, whether it's staring at them or any other type of harassment. These are adab which Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us all this time ago. And the world is coming full circle. Eventually they will come full circle and realize the hikam behind the ahkam of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no doubt about that. They are pushing for the same thing, that it's not appropriate for people to stare, for a man to stare intently with particular intention in a particular way at another at a woman as though she is something to eat or she is an object, and likewise not for a female to do that for a male. This is not from the adab of Islam. So this is the first right we have been told of the street. To lower the gaze, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Ghaddul basar, number one. Number two, kafful adha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, to the second right of the street is that you withhold performing or giving any harm. Kafful adha, stop from giving any harm. Yani, the passers-by. Stopping from harming any of the passers-by. And Imam Ibn Hajar in Fathul Bari explains this by saying, As-salama min at-ta'arrud lil-fitna bimen yamurru alayhi min imra'atin wa nahwiha. It means to not harm or to give security to those who are passing, particularly women. and allowing them safe passage without looking at them. And then the second, so that's lowering the gaze. And the second one, which is to withhold harm, this is referring to as-salama min al-ihtiqar wal-ghiba. This is referring to not backbiting and not belittling other people. This is what it means to withhold harm. That's how Ibn Hajar explains it very beautifully. So when the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us to lower our gaze, he's telling us to not look at the opposite gender. When he's telling us to withhold harm, he's telling us that when we do look at something, not to start doing ghiba about that. And not to just start doing ihtikar, which is what? Which is to belittle. So this is what we do. We walk on the street. Do you see that? Do you see those clothes that she's wearing or he's wearing? Do you see the car that he's driving or she's driving? Do you see the house that he or she is living in? Do you see what he or she is doing? Do you see what's happening over there? Belittling them and backbiting about them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The right of the road is that you protect and you do not give harm to the passersby." He said, "Sallallahu alaihi wasallam." In that you don't belittle those that are passing by. You don't backbite those that are passing by. These are the adab he's teaching us. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And finally, والأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر. والأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر. The final one that he mentioned in this riwayah is that the third right, which is due to the road, is that you command the good and prohibit the evil. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If there is evil taking place in the streets, for us to actively stop that if we are able to. For us to stop that or prevent that if we are able to. And to inculcate khair on the streets, he has told us, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So this is the right of the passage or the right of the street that we should give it. Lowering our eyes, protecting or not giving harm to the passersby in any way, and finally to command the good and prohibit the evil. This is the adab of the streets, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So alhamdulillah, we are learning here the fiqh of street life. That's what you've learned in the hadith here by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, the fiqh of street life. Now in other riwayats, the Messenger has added other rights which are due on the street. So in the version of Imam Abu Dawood, in the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawood, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has also added irshadu ibn al-sabil. He has also added that parts of the rights of the street is that a traveler, you guide the traveler, help the traveler on their journey. This is also part of the right of the tariq. Yani if you are sitting in the road, you are on the road, and somebody asks you for guidance for the right of way, you guide them towards their destination. Another one in the same riwayah, he said, tashmitul atis idha hamida. If the passerby sneezes and say alhamdulillah, you say to them, yarhamukallah. That is also a right to give to the people on the streets. Okay, in the hadith of, in the version mentioned in the Musnad of Imam al-Bazzar, there is another another extra part which is mentioned. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "A'inu 'ala al-hamula," to help those who are carrying heavy goods. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So another right of the street is that if there's anybody carrying heavy goods, particularly if they're elderly, if they're sick and they need our help, to help them carry their heavy goods. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is also a right of the streets. Okay, Imam al-Tabarani has a version of this hadith, and in his version, there is another addition, which is, أَعِينُ الْمَظْلُومِ وَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. In the version of Imam al-Tabarani, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also said that we should أَعِينُ الْمَظْلُومِ assist those who are oppressed. So if we see oppression taking place on the street, somebody is being robbed, or somebody is being insulted, somebody is being harmed, a'inul mazloom, assisting them, that's the right of the streets, not the disaster that we have in today's day and age where people are being murdered on the streets and people are making videos. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. This is how, as though the humanity has been stripped from our hearts. A'inul mazloom, he said, assist the mazloom, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's the right of the street. Wadhkurullaha kathira, and to remember Allah excessively. This is also the right of the streets, he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Next, in Abu Talha's version of the hadith, he has added wa husnul kalam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said good speech. This is so important. on the streets sometimes, people incredibly loud, so boisterous, shouting, okay, and swearing openly. Might be talking to, you know, a person on the phone, or they might be talking to a person next to them, but they will shout, they will laugh, they will swear, they will, disturb anybody that's walking past them. And unfortunately, these types of things are rife in the culture that we live in. We live in England, and the trip to the pub on Friday nights and drinking a lot is quite a commonplace activity. And unfortunately, that means that there's going to be lots of people who are raising their voices, who are shouting, who are causing general harm to the passers-by. Hatta you don't feel comfortable walking on the streets because you are disturbed. All of this is against the adab of Islam. Islam teaches us not to harm any passerby with our words or with our actions. So if we speak, then husnul kalam, good speech on the road, not harmful, and speech which will disturb others. From this also is the adab of a person in their car. Yani, there's no need to turn the music up so loud that you disturb 10 cars circling you. Why do that? What are you trying to prove, and what are you trying to show that you are someone? This is akin to a Qarun. Yani, what would he do? He would leave. He would leave out in front of his people. فَخَرَجَ عَلَى قَوْمِهِ فِي زِينَتِهِ. He would go out in front of his people, Qarun. Okay, with all of his treasure and all of his wealth on display for everybody to see. In the same way, people do the same thing. They, put the seat back, leaning very back, windows down, blasting the music, revving the car so much, or put the extra exhaust pipes on the back, just to give it that extra rev because you need people to hear your arrival. Take heed from the Quran. How did Allah deal with the arrogance of Qarun? Allah Ta'ala says, فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ. The earth swallowed him and swallowed his abode, Allah Ta'ala says. And there was nobody to help him. He was destroyed. Allah Ta'ala does not like arrogance. So husnul kalam, good speech whilst we are on the roads. In the version of Imam al-Tirmidhi, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, another right of the street is afshu salam, to spread the salam. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So to spread the salam, he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So all of these are the rights of the turuq. So this is what it means to give the rights of the turuq. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So that was a very beautiful hadith and a very important hadith that we can all implement when we are walking in the roads from the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Okay, we come now then to hadith number 191, inshallah. We will do this hadith and then we will finish on this hadith, inshallah. Bismillah. Hadith number 191.
So I've got a few questions to ask at the end. At the end, inshallah. Bismillah. فنزعه فطرح وقال أحدكم إلى جمرة من نار فيجعلها في يده فقيل للرجل بعدما ذهب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خذ خاتمك انتفئ به قال لا والله لا آخذه أبدا فقد طرحه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رواه مسلم. Ibn Abbas said that the Messenger of Allah, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, saw a gold ring on the hand of a man and removed it, and threw it away, saying, would one of you go and get a coal from the fire and put it on his hand? After the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had left, the man was told, take your ring and turn it into the Prophet. He said, no, by Prophet, I will never take something the Messenger of Allah, may Allah bless him and grant him peace, threw away.
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim wa salli alayhi. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam saw a man wearing a gold ring. And we know in Islam, gold is not permissible for males, or any jewelry for that matter is not permissible for males, except for one ring of silver, which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam permitted for a male to wear. One ring of silver is permissible. All other jewelry for males is not permissible. And this is the same in the Hanafi madhab, in the madhab of Imam Malik, it is the same. Shafi'i says the same, as does Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. So wearing jewelry from gold specifically is also definitely haram for the male. And the reason why is because Allah has made it the adornment of Jannah. And it is not to be worn by the males in this world because it is a symbol of excess wealth and arrogance. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited it for these reasons. Iyyakum wat-tana'um. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, avoid excessiveness, lavishness. فَإِنَّ عِبَادُ اللَّهِ لَيْسَ بِمُتَنَعِمِينَ. The servants of Allah are not lavish, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so we have not been permitted to wear gold in that for these reasons as males. For females, they are permitted to wear it as it is a decoration and adornment for them that Allah Ta'ala has made permissible. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw a man wearing a gold ring. فَنَزَعَهُ فَطَرَحَهُ. The messenger took the responsibility himself and he removed it from the hand of that person and he put it aside himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did that himself, alayhi salatu wa sallam. Obviously, he was Rasulullah. He is authority, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not something that we can do to somebody who's wearing it. Our duty is nasiha. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he is doing this, he is in the status of the qadi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He is in the status of the sultan sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He is the statesman. He is the leader. He is the chief judge sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So if he does it, he has complete authority to be able to do that. Our position, we are in the position of nasihin, the position of those who give counsel, the position of those who advise. This is our position. So for us, we would advise a person, brother, this is not permissible for us in Islam. That is our position, not to become judge, jury and executioner, but to give counsel for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the messenger removed it and he put it aside. And he said to him, he gave him the reason as well. He said, will one of you put an ember of fire in your hands? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, yani wearing gold, the punishment of that in the afterlife will be what? That you will be punished with the fire for wearing that, because it is completely haram for a male to wear that. So will you put? Do you want to put that fire into your hands? He's saying, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then, after the Prophet had put it aside, a man said to this Sahabi who had his ring taken off by the Messenger, خذ خاتمك انتفع به. Take your ring and benefit from it, i.e., sell it. Gift it to somebody else who can use it, give it to a female, your wife, who can use it. Yeah, do something beneficial with it. It's still yours. You don't have to wear it, but you can still take benefit from it. And that was permissible for this individual. That was permissible for him. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took it off him to show him that he can't wear it. But there's nothing in Islam that says that it cannot be owned by a male. Yes, they have to give zakat on it if it reaches the nisab. But it's nothing to say that it can't be owned, it can't be sold, it can't be gifted. All of that is jaiz. But look at the passion and look at the dedication of this companion of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, I swear by Allah, whatever Rasulullah got rid of, I will not take it again. He said, radiyallahu ta'ala. And such was his passion to be loyal to the command of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. So this is mubalagha from him. This is almost exaggeration from him in fulfilling the commands of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and being careful, very careful, not to go towards anything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited. Yani, even though it's permissible, but because the Prophet did away with it, he would not allow himself to take benefit from that. Radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, out of taqwa. So this is what he did. He did not wear it after that, radiyallahu ta'ala an. So from this hadith then we learn the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to which extent he commanded the good and prohibited the evil. And we learn the loyalty of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in to his commands and fulfilling his commands and abstaining from his prohibition, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin وآله وبارك وسلم. And with that, alhamdulillah, we've completed today's session. We will continue from hadith number 192, inshallah, in the next session, bi-idhnillah. We come to the end of this chapter and move on to the chapters which follow. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us tawfiq to act upon His words, the words of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and implement His guidance in our life, without which we are lost and without which we bring upon ourselves our own destruction. Yani, if we see failings or shortcomings in our own life, it is only because we neglect at that particular point adherence to the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. May Allah ta'ala give us tawfiq and forgive our shortcomings, inshallah. If anybody has any questions, they may ask, bi-idhnillah. The first question, salamu alaykum, alaykum salam, with regards to responding to greetings, how do you respond to a non-Muslim? You say to them, wa alaykum. So if they say, assalamu alaykum, you say, wa alaykum. I.e., you say, peace be upon you, they say, peace be upon you, you say, wa alaykum, and you as well. So you say to them, wa alaykum, and that is sufficient for them. It means peace be upon you, it means you as well. Okay, here's a question. Gold is seen as one of the best materials used for certain dental restorations. Due to its inert properties, smooth and shiny, doesn't attract food, plaque to the gums. In these medical circumstances, is it permissible to use gold, or all efforts should be used, made to use alternatives if they are clinically less effective? This is an excellent question. So, Imam Marghinani in Al-Hidayah answers this question, as do the rest of the Fuqaha in their works, with a hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where a companion had his nose sliced in jihad. He had his nose sliced in one of the battles, and to replace that particular area, he used silver initially. So he used silver as a cover for where his nose had been sliced, radiyallahu ta'ala an. The problem is, it started to rot and give off a smell. So it started to rot and give off a smell. And when it did that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him permission to use gold. He gave him permission to use gold, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, on the basis of this hadith, the fuqaha have all written, okay, the scholars of fiqh have all written, that it is permissible for a person to use gold teeth, for example, if there is a requirement for it. If there is another alter, if silver will do the job, if something else will do the job, then they may use that. But is there a permissibility to use the gold to make for that particular procedure? There is a permissibility for that, without a shadow of a doubt. So that can be used. If others are going to cause harm, if others are less effective, if they're going to wear away with time, all of these things, and gold is stronger and it is more suitable, it can be used, and that is permissible, inshallah. Wallahu a'lam. Does anybody else have any questions?
Sheikh, you know, the point about lowering the gaze, this is not related to lowering the gaze on the road, but at workplaces where, for example, you're serving customers and you're getting young to serve opposite gender. And sometimes you have to have a conversation to find out what they need and things like that. And in those scenarios, I don't know, I'm not sure, it might be wrong, but isn't looking away from the customer, understood as you're being rude.
Yeah, misconstrued as being rude. Yeah, no, that's understandable. يعني على قدر الضرورة وقدر الاستطاعة. يعني a person should avoid staring particularly, okay? And every person is more aware of what is in their own nafs and what their intention is or what they are doing. So staring should be avoided, and as much as a person can avoid having long gazes at the person, they should avoid doing that. Otherwise, if it's just as you said, the necessities of trade and commerce, they often cause that situation. The important thing is that it doesn't go beyond the had of necessity, and a person tries to the best of their ability to stop that from taking place. Any other questions?
Oh, sorry, brother.
No, it's okay, I'll ask that.
What's our opinion on someone who doesn't pray Salah? Because I think, like, the Hanbali Madhab, one strand of it, says that they're not a Muslim. And there's a hadith as well. I think in Sahih Muslim, inna bayna rajuli wa bayna shirki wal kufri tarka salah.
According to the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah and the majority of the ulama, these are hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that the difference between the servant, the Muslim, and the disbeliever is the salah. All of them are not based upon the meaning of hakiki kufr. They are based upon the understanding that an individual who doesn't perform salah, he is shabihun. He is similar to the kafir, because the kafir does not perform the salah, and this Muslim who just leaves the salah is also not performing the salah. Does leaving the salah make a person a kafir? According to the majority of the ulama and the opinion of the Ahlul Sunnah is that it does not make you a kafir. This is what the a'imma have all mentioned. And neither does performing any kabira, any major sin, make a person a disbeliever. This is the madhab of the khawarij. And Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi has a bab in his Sahih, which he has entitled as the chapter which proves that the one who is a murtakib of a kabira, the one who performs a major sin, is still a Muslim. This is the opinion of the majority of the ulama and Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So it is not kufr if a person misses the salah. This is why it is incredibly important that an individual study a hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam before doing bayan of them, and they receive ijaza in its in the riwayah of hadith and its related sciences. And if they do not have permission and yani ijaza with the shurut, yani permission with the shurut, yani they have the understanding and they are able to access the understanding as written by the ulama, then they should do bayan of the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If they do not have that ijaza and they do not have that ability and that they are not qualified, then they should refrain from doing so, lest they cause these types of misunderstandings to be spread amongst the people. So this is incredibly important for us to understand. Incredibly important. This is why the ulama Abdullah ibn Mubarak has told us al isnadu min ad-din walawla al-isnad laqala man sha'a ma sha'a. Isnad is from the deen. Yani it's an incredibly important juz of the deen. If not for chains of transmission, anybody could say whatever they want. Yani you could take any hadith of the Rasul and say this is a hadith and do bayan of it, not knowing that you've not explained the meanings properly, or you've misinterpreted its meaning, you've misunderstood its meaning, because you are unable to understand it correctly, as you've not been not able to act, you don't have ijaza, and you're unable to access what the ulama have explained with regards to it. So this is incredibly important for us to understand. Okay, there's a question. As you mentioned, lowering the gaze. What's the ruling of working with colleagues of the opposite gender? Most offices are mixed and it's unavoidable to have an individual office. And it's the same that is mentioned. I mentioned to Brother Junaid. It is unavoidable in many scenarios. A person, as much as is possible and as much as is they are able, should avoid staring at the opposite gender, especially when there is a fear of fitna and there is a fear of attraction. They should avoid that. Otherwise, naturally, you're going to see colleagues in the office that will not be accountable. Staring or looking with a desire, that will be accountable. So avoid it as much as possible. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness for our shortcomings, inshallah. Any other questions?
Sheikh, you know about the Haqq al-Tariq, where do we stand with in terms of protests?
Where do we stand in terms of protests? Protests are... If we live in a democratic country, for example, it's legal as long as it's the council, you know, give permission. Protests are legally sanctioned, therefore it is permissible. And the hukum of the protest is that you are doing amr bil ma'roof wa nahi anil munkar, you're commanding the good and you're prohibiting the evil. That should be the niyyah. However, it is very important that when we, if a protest does take place, these are often the, those occasions where everybody throws their aql down the toilet. These are often the occasions, especially the Muslims, subhanallah. This is the, these are occasions where, yeah, protests, yeah, this is where the Muslims take their aql and they dispose of it themselves. And this is a reality, okay? We will say this worst things. We will say the most unwise things. We will behave in the most unwise way. Everything we are trying to gain in terms of justice and in terms of human rights or whatever, we are doing the exact polar opposite of it at that protest. Then we want our rights to be given to us. It makes no sense whatsoever, which is why I have a distinct, very important policy. I don't attend protests. Okay, I don't believe that they are greatly effective. I believe there are other means which are far more effective and other things which we need to concentrate on. And I prefer, I prefer dedicating my time to educating and teaching. And I believe this is more important and more of a need rather than a protest after every, 2 months when a new occasion. Situations are filled with problematic incidents and problematic statements, and you by default, by being there, by default, you are also labeled as part of that. We don't do ourselves any favors, unfortunately. Everybody loses their intellect and we behave, in a very bad manner. So the haqq al-tariq when you're doing a protest then is to make sure that you do it in a humane, a mu'addab, respectful, respectful manner in terms of the words and the actions and everything that happens, and not to dispose of our own aql ourselves. Does anybody else have any other questions?
Is it alright if I ask another question?
Yeah, bismillah.
It's about how you said that we're advisors and that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took the ring off somebody. What about if you have control? For example, you might be the father or the older brother.
That's a good question. For those who are in authority, like the father, for example, or the older brother, for example, mother for her child, for example, they have full right to do that. And they should do that as well. Okay, for them, they have full right and they should do that as well. Confiscating and, putting sanctions on them in that matter to do their ta'deeb, teach them the adab of Islam is completely permissible and they should do that as well. Okay.
How often should we meet with friends as well? Because we know, like, last generations of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu. So how often should you meet with friends?
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Qadi Iyad mentions, would divide his time into three. So he would give one portion of his time to fulfill his family needs, one portion of his time for the public, and one portion of his time for his own personal hajat. And that time was also dedicated to the needs of the public as well. This is how, and then that's his own time. The rest of his time was ibadah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we should seek to look at perhaps dividing our own time in the same way. So make a portion of our time for our own personal needs, make a portion of our time for ziyarah of our family and our ikhwan, and then a portion of our time to give it to our family as well. Wallahu a'lam. Okay, with that, inshallah, we can... Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
Sheikh, just following on from Brother Junaid's question... What's the ruling regarding the likes of jalooses that take place as well?
So procession in the celebration of the Mawlid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is completely permissible. It's a practice of the Muslims the world over. Okay, the world over. It is a practice done by the Muslims in celebrating the birth of the Messenger alaihi salatu wasallam. By Muslims across the world, okay, Egypt, they have a great Mawlid of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam there, and subhanallah, it's incredibly beautiful. Everybody, the streets are filled, with everyone celebrating the Mawlid of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yemen, it is the same. Syria, it is the same. Taqriban, throughout the Muslim lands, this is a practice.